Live from New York, it's theCUBE. Covering Micron Summit 2017. Brought to you by Micron.
Welcome back to the Big Apple, everybody. This is the Micron Summit, and this is theCUBE, the worldwide leader in live tech coverage. My name is Dave Vellante, and I'm here with my co-host, David Floyer. The Micron Summit's been a day-long event announcing a number of new products. We started off with Darren Thomas was hosting. Laura Dubois from IDC gave a big picture overview of what's going on in the market. We had CIOs and practitioner discussions, but really right now we're going to get into the product, into the NVMe and NVMe over Fabric and what was announced today. A new product called SolidScale. Eric Endebrock is here. He's the Vice President of Storage Marketing at Micron. He's joined by James Meeker, who's the Director of Enterprise Solutions. Gentlemen, thanks for coming on theCUBE.
Oh, thanks for having us. Thanks, appreciate it.
You're welcome. So Eric, let's start with you. I was picking up on what you said. You had talked about, hey, if you're going to be at OpenStack next week, which by the way we are, theCUBE will be here. I was yesterday at Red Hat Summit, and it was a big discussion about workloads. And of course, OpenStack's a big component of Red Hat's business, and they were talking about modernizing, you know, workloads, how workloads are diversifying. Many, many examples, whether it was, you know, WebSphere or WebLogic. They even gave a JBoss. You'd think JBoss is pretty modern, but no. Things are changing so fast. So maybe start there. What's changing in the world of workloads, and how is sort of Flash supporting those changes?
Yeah, and in some cases, it might be what isn't changing, and that's also part of the challenge that we're facing. And so as we think about Flash and you know, being memory, it's very tunable. The problem is we've, for a lot of very valid reasons, we made really fairly smart and intelligent memory look like a hard drive, a spinning media. And we did that so we didn't have to rewrite code. And a lot of great reasons, it makes substitution great, but it leaves huge amounts of performance capability just left orphaned on the table. And, you know, we do some work in Austin, a lot of software development. One of our key pieces is actually how do we break through that for workloads. And, you know, what we find, we call it write amplification, but you know, every time I want to write one byte onto an SSD, you know, by the time I get up to an application level, through all the different things, file systems, the application itself, even the firmware on the SSD, you'll find that, you know, I'm probably writing hundreds, if not thousands, of bytes of data all the way down at the very bottom of that stack. And so that's a piece where we really have got to, as an industry, kind of break free and unleash some of the value of Flash, because that's the next frontier. If we can create a much more direct access layer from those workloads, they're going to get a lot more performance out of it. And you know, that's just one piece, sorry, a long answer, I guess.
No, that's great.
But you know, you think about what that looks like, and that was a storage question you asked, but it's the same question if you think about memory and in-memory databases and where these applications and workloads are going. We've got to fit more in memory, which is going to take memory extension technologies, many of which are based on Flash and 3D XPoint and other technologies. And then at the same time, I've got to have the storage that's fast enough and big enough to feed them, especially as these algorithms start creating that data.
So James, you're in Austin.
That's right.
A lot of the software is being developed. Sort of what's the crux of the initiative there? Is it to eliminate what I referred to this morning as the horrible storage stack?
Well, we've been focusing on how do you take a great technology like NVMe over F that has super low latency, and how do you get that performance, that capacity outside of a single server and share it with all of your servers and all of your applications. Latency typically will get lost across your fabric and applications won't be able to take advantage of it. And so one of the big things we did today was introduce SolidScale. And SolidScale is an architecture that we're delivering that allows you to share NVMe low latency benefits, high capacity across all of your servers. And we focused on that as the key product delivery today.
So how would I, as an end user, take your product and actually utilize it? What are the steps that I would go through to actually to get some value out of it?
Sure.
Try it out.
So for many customers, they'll have a specific application or a workload profile that they'll want to deploy this technology on. In many cases, you've got workloads like analytics, big data type applications that you would want to architect around specific densities and performance targets. The SolidScale structure is flexible enough in not only how you deploy it, but how you architect it, that you can scale your storage in a node-to-node scale-out type configuration, or have a consolidated centralized storage configuration for flexibility with your application deployment, depending on really what are the needs of your users and the I/O patterns that you're trying to improve.
Could I jump in real
you
quick?
Sure,
so, yeah. So a piece of that, though, is, you know, I think James did a great job describing the architectural view of that. Mm-hmm. Very mechanically, we see the easiest way. Most customers are deploying rack scale these days. So in these early phases, we're producing this on a 24U rack.
Right.
And so we'll roll it in. It's got top of rack switching.
Right.
So that connect out to your general purpose fabric. And you've got to be very flexible with that. People have fabric choices they want to make. And then you have your Mellanox infrastructure for within that, the solid scale appliance piece itself. And then you still have quite a bit of room, of course, power and PDUs and things like that. But in the middle, then you've got space to put in compute if you choose to do it there. And again, a very customer-centric choice, not trying to necessarily define what their compute architecture looks like. So I think we've made it very easy to get this into an environment, you know, physically, very practically.
Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. Plug it in, get that part running, and then if you choose to, you know, very easily connect it out into your broader network. But the key is keeping that very high speed, low latency traffic kind of isolated to where you need it.
Right.
That's an important part.
So what one of the areas that when I've talked to people about this is the excitement is being able to combine sort of transactional systems with the analytics, mm-hmm. the artificial intelligence, the background, and combine it in two ways. First of all, to be able to share the data between the two, so that you have a different view of the data, but it's actually the same physical data, but it's two logical looks at it. And then secondly, to be able to, in real time, get the analytics over to the transactional system itself. So, and to me, the business value of that, or to the people I've talked to, the potential business value of that is enormous in terms of what it can do to the productivity of a company, either like Micron in the area of manufacturing, or to any other company at all. How would you put your technology? How would you work with your customers to put this technology into such an environment?
I mean, you want me to grab that?
Sure, go ahead.
Give it a shot. So, you know, I think it's a great question. And the vision you describe, I think, is the one everybody's after, right? If you think of IoT and any kind of data consumption, as this massive dump of data comes in. How do I collapse that to the 2% of it that might be actually valuable, the insights hidden within that haystack, if you will, of data, and potentially discard the rest or do whatever you're going to do with it, but at the same time, you know, connect to that transaction piece. You know, we have a very small but very specialized consulting group, and so we definitely work with our customers. Part of how we got to solid scale, in fact, is a piece of this customers coming to us asking for exactly what you've described. For many years, we've had a team very focused on working with anybody who wanted to build and deploy flash or memory in any way. And again, you can tune flash, you can customize it, you can reprogram it, do a lot of things, but you can also destroy it if you do that incorrectly. So we had a team that's very focused on that. We've been building and retooling that team as well to be much more workload aware. And so through this, I guess, advisory group, team that we focus on this area, that's how we generally approach this with customers. Now, they know their apps best. I don't want to pretend that, you know, Micron's coming in and advising them on how to architect and build their full solutions. That's not the case. But what we can do and what we have tested and what James and a lot of our engineers are doing every day in Austin and throughout our labs is finding ways to break it and finding what doesn't work. So a lot of our value is making sure you avoid just common pitfalls so that you don't actually sub-optimize it. If you're dealing with 200 microseconds, one screw-up turns that into 1,000, and anybody can get 1,000 microseconds out of a system. So, you know, you got to stay pretty tight on focus if you're going to reap the rewards.
You bring up a really good question. The IoT applications, the analytic cutting-edge type applications need an infrastructure that has these ultra low latencies in order to process the inbound data. And so we've really focused on that as a company, as a as an engineering group, to try to deliver solutions to enable customers to port over their applications and face new challenges that are high speed, low latency, with an infrastructure that can scale out to support their businesses. And that's what SolidScale's been about.
So I got a question for the three of you, maybe. So I feel like we've been solving the same storage problem for years. If I go back to sort of the late 90s, early 2000s, the storage area network, it was supposed to be the centralized pool of storage, sort of improve utilization, improve performance, certainly, because you're offloading the host. There was an availability component as well. When I read your press release today, I said, it's like back to the future.
Yeah, exactly.
Are we really going to solve it this time, is my question, right? So, and I think the reality is, okay, so we made some progress on things like utilization, and obviously performance easily was eaten up by the exponential data growth. But what's your take on that, maybe, James, if you could maybe look back and say, okay, this is, the industry solved some problems, but boy, they fell down in terms of meeting the promise. I feel like it's, you know, the old data warehouse. Oh, it's going to save the world in 360-degree view of your customer, and it didn't happen. And so will we get there this time is really my question.
Yeah, I think we're really seeing a tipping point in the industry. We've recognized that there's boundaries on how fast you can actually go, how many cores can you put in the CPU. It's about getting your data closer to your processor. It's about being able to feed all of those cores inside your racks of servers. And flash is inherently a technology that allows people to move their data closer to the CPU to process more. And it brings a lot of benefits, and it also brings a lot of challenges. And so when we start thinking through, would you design flash or storage solution today with flash technologies, if you had to do it all from scratch? If you started out back when hard drives came out or SSDs entered the market, it kind of had to fit the norms of what a hard drive looked like when we launched SSDs. But if you did it today and you know what you know about flash and the benefits it could bring, you would re-architect the whole solution to take advantage of the power and the low latency and the benefits that you get from a solid state data center. And that's our vision. We're going to get it right this time by starting grounds up, by looking at flash as the medium to solve data center and storage problems.
And I think one of our CIOs said it right, though. As soon as we solve this problem, we're probably breaking another.
Absolutely.
And so, you know, and we know that already. We can saturate any fabric that's in existence
today. You're pushing the bottleneck.
So now I'm just pushing it to somewhere else, and so we'll jump ahead and do something clever there. So, you know, it's definitely a rat race, but...
But we can pound on the networking guys for a while.
You know, I don't mind. The storage guys, we don't mind taking the beating. That's okay, as long as you keep calling. But, you know, and you know, James and I spent many years in former lives, you know, building storage systems and changing over from fiber channel. Or actually, I like to think of it as you always see those evolution things, you know, and you got the, you know, people standing upright and walking around, that evolution thing. I kind of think of it in storage world, you know, we were direct attach and dedicated in the mainframe, and then we went open solutions and we put it in direct attach and it was cheaper. Then we went to SANs and it was all good, and then we kind of shrunk back to direct attach again. And that's sort of where we've been with flash. It's like that's how you take the most advantage of it.
Right.
And what we're trying to do with SolidScale is break that free one more time. So, you know, it does. It cycles, I guess.
Just answering in a slightly different way. If you go back to the SAN days, with disk, you were lucky if you could get 10 milliseconds with disk. With flash, you got it down to around 1 millisecond, 1 to 2 milliseconds, when you looked at the real averages. What we're talking about now is 200 milliseconds to the actual data, and within the previous generation of SAN, if you went off that
200
particular
milliseconds.
Microseconds.
Is where we are.
If you, in the SAN environment, if you went from one CPU to another, to the data on another, that was a long, long, long drive there and back. That was many, many milliseconds
so that's
to do. Now you're down to just 5 microseconds.
Okay, so let me pick up on something in your press release, because I'd like to clarify it here in theCUBE, because I was a little bit confused, and you had said you got it, but let's get out there. One of the bullets was optimized performance. So the speed of the Micron NVMe SSDs coupled with high bandwidth Mellanox fabric delivers performance that scales by adding an average of 5 microseconds of additional latency to an application's data path when compared to a local in-server NVMe.
Yep.
Micron's solid-scale architecture is expected to reduce end-to-end latency to under 200 microseconds.
Yep.
Okay. Can you explain that in layperson's?
Yeah, well, I'll grab it. So, you know, if in our testing, you get about 195 microseconds. And the way, I got this wrong yesterday with the milli and micro. They told me to say, well, just say micron. That's the one. So I said, well, that helped, actually. So I've got it right today, at least so far. But it's about 195 microseconds end to end on that transaction when it's local. So that's what an NVMe bus today does. Now, obviously, there'll be improvements there. Gen 4, a lot of great stuff happening there that we're all over. Our design goal, as I mentioned in the presentation real quick, was to say, how can I create as the same or not much worse, in the worst case, a centralized pool that you could do it. And so we add, on average, 5 microseconds over being local. And that what that's saying in the press release is, you know, for a 5 microsecond penalty, you can unleash that flash from being direct and dedicated to an individual server and get all the benefits of that shared accelerated
the pooling
storage.
Pooling and sharing.
Better management, everything.
Yeah. Much simpler, lower cost of ownership, all that.
Absolutely.
Yeah. The software stack doesn't get in the way of your latency improvements. You're going directly to these huge pools of NVMe and across your fabric, and you're getting access to all your remote data as if it were a local drive. And that's what's phenomenal. The software is not in way of the benefits and the goodness that you get from this technology.
Yeah, well, please.
Well, I was going to say, you might even mention bypassing the CPU in some cases to get the
absolutely
most out of it.
Absolutely. So that's another thing that really is a challenge for a lot of customers, is that to manage the I.O., it consumes CPU cycles. In many cases, it can be 20 to 22% of your CPU cycles will be dedicated to managing the I.O. On your servers. By bypassing this or offloading your I.O. requests, it frees up your CPU, so you get a better TCO, you've got more virtualized machines or more processes running on your clients. And that also not only solves an I.O. problem, but it gives a better value to the customer to increase their density of servers in a rack.
Yeah. And that's game-changing. That comes back to workloads. Eric, you talked about VMware and vSAN at the top, which is now VMware is the new legacy. You know, sorry, Pat Gelsinger, but it's true.
We're onto containers and other things.
Right, we're onto containers and Kubernetes and Mesospheres and all that cool stuff, and that's a whole new world. And you're talking about orders of magnitude of performance increase and the ability to handle more data, share data. Good stuff.
You know, Dave, one thing, you mentioned the workload and kind of circling it back around to that. I mean, one of the interesting things, and I think the phenomenon that may be the game changer that does change this and maybe solves it a little differently than we have in the past is, you take any Fortune 1000 company, we're running tens of thousands of applications. A lot of what we're solving for are companies who are running 10 applications. They're more focused apps, they're bigger, they're scale out in all those cases that I'm kind of describing, but they're also tunable. And those are the companies that came to Micron and said, you know what, I've got a very unique problem, but I can actually very uniquely solve it because I wrote the code in many cases, or I have 100% understanding of how every piece of it works. And so they were really the catalyst for solid scale. And you call them hyperscales or cloud vendors, whatever any number of these different kind of companies look and feel like, but their ability to so granularly control their environment is allowing us to do really great things with flash with them. And part of solid scale was saying, you know what, how do we take that out further? How do we push that to the edge and get it more broadly available and still be unique and value add? Solving a VMware vSAN, you mentioned its legacy, that was great learning for us. I think we made a great system. It had a lot of value and customers really liked that, but it's a whole new level with solid scale. That takes it to the next level.
Yeah, and those are the apps that are changing the world. And like it or not, folks, it's coming. Gentlemen, thanks very much for coming.
Appreciate it. Thanks.
Great. All right, keep it right there, everybody. We'll be back with our next guest right after this. We're live from Micron Summit in New York City. This is theCUBE.
Robert Herjavec. People obviously